friendly. The Yellow Jackets have come to Duke 20 times, and 17 times they have flown home losers. Bobby Kremitz will have to get big plays out of his inside guys to break the Blue Devils' spell. But Mike Krzyzewski has quite a few tricks up his sleeves as Duke looks to continue its mastery over the Yellow Jackets. It's Duke and Georgia Tech next. And 9,314 crammed into Cameron Indoor Stadium on the Duke campus as number 12 Georgia Tech goes head-to-head with the Duke Blue Devils. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Bob Rathman along with Bucky Waters. Great to have you with us for ACC basketball today. And not too many easy games right now for the Yellow Jackets, Buck. They are going through a real tough time on their schedule.
Well, they really are. As you look at it, he's got to make better friends with Homer Rice, the athletic director. This looks like a card at the holiday season from the Marquis de Sade saying, have a nice holiday, Bobby. And he's just halfway through it. He's a very concerned coach.
And we talked with Bobby earlier today and asked him about this stretch of games.
Yeah, I was disappointed in the Maryland loss because I kind of knew what we had ahead of us. You know, Duke and North Carolina, Louisville, then back in the ACC. I knew it was going to be a very, very difficult stretch. So if you want to live healthy, the best thing to do is get the wins you're supposed to get. Now, of course, we put ourselves behind the eight ball and we got to fight back.
And when you analyze this game today, Bucky, you really chop it up to an inside game and an outside game. In the paint today, Georgia Tech must get a big game from Evander Newbill to combat Duke's inside presence.
Well, Bob, he's a senior, and he's got the beef to stand up to Duke. Eddie Elisma is a coming freshman, very quick to the ball, but skinny. This guy's got to do it for him.
We mentioned to Bobby earlier this year about Newbill's contributions.
You know, we know Ivano's not Montrose, Cherokee Parks, or Sharon Wright. We know that. I watched Ivano coming out of high school. I really liked him. I thought he could be a great complimentary player. We need him to get tougher, and we need a big year out of Ivano.
The man that Ivano will be guarding today, at least part of the time, will be Cherokee Parks, and the Chief is coming off a huge game against Clemson on Wednesday night.
Well, this guy's up and down. Sharon Wright brought out the best in him. But the key for him today is to get on that offensive board. This has been something that has really given Georgia Tech fits all year. And a performance like that against a great center in Sharon Wright, you have to wonder how devastating he can be against the Yellow Jackets.
Well, that's the inside game. Outside today, particularly for Duke defensively, a most intriguing matchup as Grant Hill at 6'8" will guard Travis Best. And you see what happened a couple of years ago in Atlanta.
Yeah, that's true. And that's really a tribute to Grant's great defensive ability. He was voted last year the best college defensive player. But it was also the fact that Travis was a freshman. And he's a little bit better now. In fact, he's a whole lot better.
Coach K will be using his man Grant Hill at the point today. But you know he'll be all over the place.
If you have kids that are versatile, we try not to limit them in the system, so we let them do a number of different things. So Grant will bring the ball up a lot of times, but once he passes the ball, he might not get it back to dribble it again. Hopefully he'll get it back to shoot it again.
Well, that's the way the coaches see it. Mike Krzyzewski of Duke, Bobby Kremitz from Georgia Tech. We'll talk more about our matchup from Durham after this word from our good friends at Bud Light. It's number 12 Georgia Tech against number 3 Duke here at Cameron Indoor Stadium today. And playing at home is a big benefit for the Dukies. They've won 67 of their last 70 here. And the one team that they've really pounded in conference competition is Georgia Tech. Bucky, what's the mindset for the Yellow Jackets coming in here today?
Well, of course, they won 2 out of 3 last year. They lost by 10 in this building. So it's not like a total disaster coming in. And this is a veteran team. These four guys that started won the tournament last year. And of course, beat Duke and knocked them out of the tournament. So I think their mindset's pretty good. To win in here, you have to have good guard play. And Georgia Tech has it. The other thing that helps them is they're unstructured offensively, which makes it very difficult for Duke's pressure defense to really break them down and rip them. And when that happens, the crowd gets in it. So good guards and the fact that they're unstructured give Georgia Tech a chance.
Okay, let's check out the four keys to the game. And we've highlighted defensive rebounding for Georgia Tech, Bucky, because the other night against Maryland, Tech was just killed on the offensive board.
Yeah, we'll see Joe Smith here, just a freshman from Maryland coming in to put it away. And they won the Holiday Festival in New York and gave up 50 offensive rebounds in 2 nights. That's a problem. containing Travis Best. We've already said Mike Krzyzewski's putting his best player on him. This guy is a fantastic point guard. Last year he scored. He led the ACC from three-point land at 45%. That percentage is down, but he's a much better passer this year, and he's actually inspired by Bobby Hurley's point defense, is doing a terrific job pressuring the ball. He's all around. He's a good one.
We'll be keeping an eye on Travis Best. He can beat you in so many ways off the screen, as you saw, but also in the transition game. We'll continue with more as Georgia Tech meets Duke right after these messages.
And Jefferson Pilot Sports present the best in college basketball, the Atlantic Coast Conference. Today's game is brought to you by U.S. Air, Nations Bank, Discus Athletic, MCI, Food Lion, Ford Mustang, Bud Light, and by the Jefferson Pilot Life Insurance Company.
The Cameron Crazies are here. They're getting set for ACC basketball, the first home ACC game for the Blue Devils this year, as they play host to the number 12 Yellow Jackets from Georgia Tech. Hi, everybody. Bob Rathman along with Bucky Waters. Welcome to our coverage from Cameron Indoor Stadium today. And let's take a look at the starting lineups. First of all, for the visitors from Atlanta. And they will go with Martise Moore at a forward position along with James Forrest. Evander Newbill in the middle with Travis Best and Drew Berry in the backcourt. Forrest, Bucky, is coming off a career best 36 on Tuesday night against the Maryland Terrapins.
Well, this is a perimeter team, but the man inside is James Forrest. And he went 13 for 15 against the Blue Devils in the ACC tournament. They're going to know where to find him on the blocks.
And for the Duke Blue Devils, Grant Hill and Antonio Lang start along with Cherokee Parks. In the backcourt, Jeff Capel, the freshman, and Chris Collins, the sophomore. Grant Hill is asked to do a lot of things. He's got his hands full today with Travis Best.
Yeah, and he's also going to have a man-sized role in handling that offense. When you have a guy that can do so many things, it's a nice problem to have, but you have to keep remembering, get him the ball.
Amen. Duke is coming off a victory at Clemson. Georgia Tech a loss against the Maryland Terrapins. We'll see how it turns out today. It's Duke against Georgia Tech, and we'll be back with the opening tip-off from today's game right after this. A 6'5" guard and a sophomore. Georgia Tech and Duke, the Blue Devils unbeaten at 8-0. Overall, the Yellow Jackets are 9-2. Bobby Crummins, the head coach in Atlanta in his 13th season at Georgia Tech. And if he wins today, number 250 at Georgia Tech and number 350 in his marvelous coaching career. Another marvelous career here in Durham from Mike Krzyzewski. The Iowa victory was number 400 in his career. And you see his numbers at Duke lifetime, 19-13 against the Yellow Jackets. Well, the students are back. They've got their tickets punched, and they're ready for some ACC basketball.
By the looks of some of them, they had more than that punched over the holidays. And it's not even a full moon. They're ready. They've been starved for Duke hoops. They're ready.
Duke Edsel, Steve Gordon, and Mike Wood are the officials this afternoon. As many of you saw earlier today, the North Carolina Tar Heels with a five-point victory over Maryland. More ACC action will be updating you at halftime. In this series, Duke leads 33-17, Tech winning 2 of 3 last year, including that quarterfinal victory in the ACC tournament. Cherokee Parks coming off a huge game. He's averaging 15 points and just under 10 rebounds per game. Grant Hill ready to go for the Blue Devils. New build to jump against Parks, and it was hit on the way up, and the ball will belong to the Blue Devils.
Ivano trying to get a little jump start there. Got it on the way up. Actually, I think he got it almost before it got above Cherokee's eyebrows. I'll tell you, the Georgia Tech team has not started well. And obviously, Maryland, they were down 17-3. They did the same thing in New York. They've had a tough time getting started.
Chris Collins guarded by Travis Best. This is Grant Hill. He's matched up with Martise Moore. A lot of pushing and shoving inside with Parks and Newbill. This is Lang for the turnaround. Cross court, Martise Moore to the trailing Newbill. Not an offensive threat. Parks is allowed to freelance in the lane a little bit defensively. Onubil going to work. And scores. Ivan Onubil, a redshirt, fifth year senior. That's his first basket in Cameron Indoor Stadium.
All signs pointing well for Georgia Tech so far, holding Duke to one shot, getting the defensive rebound, going to the other end, and getting points inside.
Cherokee with his first basket, ties it at two. Best can really use those screens effectively to get three for the jump shot.
He's one player that has really benefited with the elimination of the five-second closely guarded off the dribble. He used to be forced to give it up. Now he keeps it, takes his sweet old time, and makes something good happen.
Boy, off balance.
Travis Best.
And Best puts it home.
Grant Hill at 6'8 will give him some problems, even though Best has a quick release. Hill has very long arms and, of course, a terrific defensive player.
That's a travel on Grant Hill. The turnover gives Georgia Tech the basketball. I thought Mike Krzyzewski in practice yesterday, Bucky, made a very interesting observation about Bobby Kremins at Georgia Tech. He said teams in this league, when they're coming off a loss, they turn it up a notch. And this is a different start for Tech today than we saw the other night against Maryland.
They got caught napping at home against a dangerous Maryland team, but nevertheless, that's a game that Georgia Tech expected to win.
Forrest. Here's Newbill with an offensive rebound. Three white shirts around him, and the big fella scores. Newbill with four of Georgia Tech's six. Grant is short with it. And Berry, the rebound. Martise Moore, the MVP of the Holiday Festival in December. James, triple team. Back out to Martise. Shot clock at 16. Great pass to Newbill. The rebound belongs to Georgia Tech.
So far, the Yellow Jackets very poised in here. I mean, this crowd really went to get on a run and just holler them right out of the joint. They're playing very smart.
Bucky, you mentioned earlier, a veteran team can handle the effects of the Cameron Grazers.
Guard play is so important. You want to keep Duke on defense as long as possible.
Martise Moore buries it, and Georgia Tech leads 8-2.
When they defeated Temple, they started 6 minutes without scoring in the first half, almost 6 minutes to start the second half. They did the same thing, digging a hole against St. John's in the championship in New York. They got down 17 zip, so this is a great new beginning for Georgia Tech.
Best. And we've got a whistle. And a foul on the Yellow Jacket from Son Newbill. Got a lot of contact with Travis Best.
Foul was on Georgia Tech's number 33, Ivano Newbill.
The lefty with the knifing penetration. Gets a step, but there's where that size by Grant Hill came into play. And a rollover. I hope he had his chin strap on tight.
Georgia Tech leading 8-4. Grant Hill. And Berry up ahead of the pack. The number is not in his favor. Nice feed to Forrest. He's hammered by Jeff Capel. This looks like a completely different Georgia Tech team than we saw against Maryland on Tuesday.
Drew Barry, with the good vision, finds James Forrest underneath. Jeff Capel, the freshman from Fayetteville, needed a club. He made sure, however, there would be no three-point play. If James is going to get two, he's going to get him from 15 feet. Look at that body.
First point for James Forrest. He's a 67% free throw shooter, leads the Jackets in scoring at 19.7 per game. That ranks him fifth in the ACC. 10-4 Georgia Tech, 15:59 to play in the first half, and a timeout on the floor. We'll be back after a word from our good friends at Bud Light.
Georgia Tech down inside. That penetration pass should be tougher to make against the Duke defense, but it isn't. Ivano Newbill, who leads Georgia Tech in field goal percentage, takes on the whole front line of the Blue Devils and gets a stick back. Rebounding so far, an astonishing 5-0 with the Yellow Jackets on top. And Ivano Newbill is filled with confidence.
Bobby Crummins was telling us this morning that he needed to show more confidence in Newbill, give him some time inside. And it's out of bounds to Georgia Tech. Well, Newbill played only 3 minutes Tuesday against the Terps.
Well, I think the frantic pace of that Maryland game just wasn't set for him. They got caught up in the track meet.
Georgia Tech leading 10-4.
Out of that timeout, Georgia Tech went to a 2-3 matchup on that last defensive set. A defensive change that's interesting since they were doing so well in the man-for-man.
Drew Barry with the soft touch. 12-4 Yellow Jackets. This Cameron crowd waiting for the Dukies to get rolling. Collins with a three.
As soon as they went to that matchup, Chris Collins' eyes got very large. Does he like to see zones?
Newbill set the screen for Best, gets it back and lays it in. Ivano Newbill, who had not scored a point in 65 career minutes in Cameron Indoor Stadium, has six.
Grant Hill has taken the dribble penetration away from Travis Best, but Georgia Tech is able to make the entry pass inside to the post area at will, and that should be a lot tougher against a Mike Krzyzewski defense.
Grant Hill, in and out. Capel will control it. And there is Newbill to snuff it. Jump ball and the possession arrow will give the ball to Georgia Tech. Jeff Capel, welcome to the ACC, my friend.
The freshman tries to go in the face of Ivano Newbill, and Ivano says, not now and not here.
That's the third Duke turnover, 14-7. Georgia Tech leading. Clark is in the ball game for the Blue Devils.
Forrest throwing double coverage when he gets the pass down in the post. Boy, Tech doing a nice job of moving. Duke not able to pressure, just not in a pressure mode. Georgia Tech having its way with its half-court offense.
16-7. Deflected, Parks recovers, back to Grant. Hill having a tough time early shooting the basketball. Here's Tech in transition, 3-on-3. Best pull-up. And Collins, 6-3 inside, gets the rebound. Grant Hill is 0-for-4 from the field. Collins connects. Chris with 5, at 16-9, Georgia Tech.
Boy, what a tough shot that was. A little spin, a little half turn. He was going east and west and shot it north and south. Oh!
Forrest draws a lot of attention. Newbill with a left-hand hook and good. Ivano Newbill with 8 first-half points. Incredible. And Forrest is on the back of Tony Lang. First foul for James, the 6'8 junior from Atlanta.
Fouls on Georgia Tech's number 34, James Forrest.
18-9, Yellow Jackets. And remind your friends to stay tuned at halftime for the Volkswagen ACC Women's Report. Eric Meek is in the ballgame for Duke, number 52. And there's Eddie Alisma checking in for the Yellow Jackets. Newbill's going to get a breather, along with Cherokee Parks.
Well, I have to believe Newbill was really tired because the way he was playing, it's the best he's played I've ever seen him play ever.
Collins driving, laying it up and in. Chris Collins has 7. And he's keeping Duke in this game. Got his hands full with Martise Moore, that's for sure. Best. Duke is running with Collins. On the wing, Grant Hill. That's a charge, no basket.
What a gutsy play by Travis Best. Collins in the middle, gave the ball up. Grant Hill a bit frustrated. Senior's not supposed to make that play. Travis Best back there. He had to assume that Travis wasn't going to challenge for the block, that he would be looking for good position with his quickness to take the charge, and it paid off. Grant Hill, of course, accepting the defensive challenge on Travis Best. It appears with 8 minutes gone that it's taken a lot off his offensive game so far.
Four Duke turnovers in the early going. James Forrest connects.
Basket by James.
Six for the big fella. 20 to 11 now. Georgia Tech is leading. Well, Georgia Tech has taken advantage of those Duke turnovers. They now have 8 points off the four Duke turnovers. Collins cross courts it to Clark. Shovels to Lang. Scoring. And a foul on Elise. Duke's had some problems, Bucky, in the half-court offense early in this game. But nice ball movement here.
The matchup has him standing. Clark with nice dribble penetration. Just an excellent pass. Eddie Elisma coming from the weak side, as a freshman often is. He was hanging on the weak side of that board, thinking there was going to be a shot. And percentage says that's a good place to be for the rebound. But it left him a step short, covering defensively.
11:32 remaining, first half at Cameron Indoor Stadium. It's the Yellow Jackets by six. 1985, only North Carolina and Duke have more ACC victories than that man, Bobby Crummins. Mike Krzyzewski, Duke's winningest coach, and each coach with three ACC tournament championships.
Boy, that one last year was absolutely amazing. Crummins came into Charlotte needing what he felt was one win to make sure he made the NCAA tournament. And he went right through Duke, Clemson, and eventual national champion North Carolina. Three games, three nights, with no depth, and he did it. And then, amazingly, as their season went last year, they got taken out in the first round by Southern University after leading at the half. They were a complete enigma last year, but this is a more veteran team. Four starters back.
And a poised team. First half here at Cameron Indoor Stadium. Georgia Tech is led from the outset. Forrest had some space and put it in. James has eight.
You hit a key term there, Bob. Space against the Duke defense is very important, and they're doing a beautiful job of keeping the spacing and making that entry pass.
Barry with his head up, looking to rifle the pass. He does to Forrest, and he puts it in. James with 10. 24-14, Yellow Jackets. A great feed from Drew Barry.
Georgia Tech not only having its way with its half-court offense against Duke, it's now beating the Blue Devils down the floor. And I'll tell you, Duke is a great transition team from defense to offense. They're also a very good team from offense back to defense. They're just not ready to play today.
That was the first basket from Grant Hill. Vincent is open, and he puts it home. Brent Vincent, the outside sharpshooter from Murfreesboro, North Carolina, makes it 27-16, Yellow Jackets. Parks rolls it up and off. Barry the rebound. And up ahead, here's Forrest. Boy, they run the floor. Great transition. Foul on Marty Clark.
A complete transformation. Georgia Tech defensively is solid. They're limiting Duke to one shot, and they are running. Look at this. Looks like a bus moves like a greyhound. Marty Clark got in front of that. Would you believe that? And he's a senior. These guys are supposed to be smarter than that.
It's easier to get in front of a freight train.
Number 34, James.
Look at that. He's got muscles in places most people don't even have places. Good gracious.
James Forrest bangs in the foul shot, his 11th first half point. Toward the conclusion of our telecast, we'll be announcing the players of the game, brought to you by Nations Bank. Two for two for James, a dozen points. Georgia Tech with a 13-point lead here at Duke. 9:51 to play in the half, and that represents the biggest spread here in the first half for the Jackets.
An amazing game in Cameron here last year. Duke won by 10. But Georgia Tech led by two at the half. And it, of course, was the only time that Duke beat Georgia Tech last year.
the best on him, takes him into the paint, and misses. Drew Berry, look at Tech run. They've got a 4-on-2 coming to Duke. Benson drops it, picks it up, double dribble.
Travis Best, very frustrated. Drew Berry, he wants Drew Berry to give that ball up quicker. Boy, Berry is very cavalier with the ball. I mean, he throws cross-court passes in transition. He's oblivious to, I mean, fearless.
Grant Hill, the Chief, dunks it. Six up for Parks, it's 29-18.
Well, that's the answer for the big men. If they can't find you with the pass, you can always get it off the glass. And the way Duke has been shooting, there are lots of offensive rebounding opportunities.
Parks jumps out, but Best Hill is able to squeeze the trigger. Foul on Berry. McGrew, it's his first. And that is the fourth team foul here in the first half on the Yellow Jackets. 8:49 remaining in the first half. Tech 29 and Duke 18.
Number 44 to Cherokee with a pump fake. Takes the freshman soaring. Eddie Elisman goes flying over, and the Chief just kind of hangs out a little bit and then powers it home.
Changes for Georgia Tech. Ivano Newbill back at the ball game. He's in there along with Forrest, Moore, Berry, and Vincent. Best is up. Duke comes with Grant Hill, Marty Clark, Lang, Parks, and Collins. Collins for three. Chris with a big first half. He's hit 2 3-pointers and he's scored 10.
And you can be sure they'll keep going to him until he turns cold. Watch Grant Hill just seek him out. When you got a guy with a hot ball like that, you go to him.
Newbill back out to Berry. And Drew retaliates with a three.
Of course, Georgia Tech doesn't have quite that simplicity. Everybody's hot.
Collins. Oh, boy. Longer than the last one. 13 for Chris. Tremendous range on that three-point shot for Chris. Vincent working on Clark. Into Newbill, great block by Grant Hill, but he also got him with the body. Second personal on Grant.
Grant Hill is guarding Travis Best, but the second ball handler, the league's leading assist guy, Drew Berry, has taken over and enabled Georgia Tech to keep Duke on defense and be very patient until they get the opportunity they want. So far, Grant Hill's done a good job defensively on Travis Best, but has not been able to manage the Duke offense. The Duke offense so far has been Chris Collins.
Vano Newbill had scored 6 points in 8 career games against the Blue Devils before today. If he hits his free throw, he'll have 10 first half points.
His teammates showed a lot of confidence going to him early, and he didn't let him down.
Lang secures, and Grant Hill brings it up. Grant Hill having a tough day shooting the basketball. He is just 1 for 7. Collins has picked up the slack, and he's open. Vincent gets it ahead to Berry. Drew leaves it for Newbill and gets it back, and that Tech works offensive. Berry on the baseline. Forrest. There's Vincent with the offensive rebound. Back up and in. Fred Vincent with 5. He averages 11 points a game off the Tech bench.
But mostly he's a perimeter player. He had 5 threes against St. John's in Madison Square Garden. 5 for 7, in fact. That's usually where he does his damage. He took that offensive rebound right over Grant Hill.
Monty Clark is there to reverse it, but Grant Hill really having a tough time.
Marty Clark has been a big substitution for the Blue Devils. He's really helped get him going. It's now a 9-point game.
James Forrest. The Chief gets it out to Collins. Down the lane, a Tony thought that the shot was going to go up. And the turnover gives it back to Georgia Tech. Timeout on the floor, 6:13 left in the first half with Georgia Tech in control. Look at an MCI proof positive instant replay. And on this one, Grant Hill will take the shot, but keep an eye on Marty Clark.
Coming from the weak side, James Forrest just not checking off, and that was a tough rebound. Really didn't come off there soft, almost a clanger. Marty Clark, a good substitution for the Blue Devils. He has helped off that bench to get him going. And now Mike going to a smaller lineup out there. Three guards.
In addition to Clark, Jeff Capel and Doug Collins, along with Lang and Parks. Georgia Tech has shot the ball very well today, 67%. They've hit 14 out of 21. They came in shooting 45% for the season. Much better offensive team than those season statistics would indicate. Too far on an eight. That time from Artis Moore.
Set play out of the timeout. Almost worked.
Clark. That's a three. Marty's first three-pointer of the game and just his fourth of the season.
You know, the game was billed as the strength of the big Duke front line versus the perimeter game of Georgia Tech. And with Collins and Clark, it has been the complete reverse. It has been the Duke perimeter. And the fact that Tech has really ruled the inside.
Newville back out to Moore. And the three, right back for Georgia Tech. Artis with his fifth point and first three-pointer. That's twice in this game. Duke has hit a three, only to see Georgia Tech come back and neutralize it with a three of their own.
Yeah, but the defensive intensity that time was greater for Duke. They're definitely picking it up. The smaller lineup is giving them more quickness.
Antonio Lang cuts it to seven. Steal by Capel.
Great hands.
Collins has held the hot hand. The runner is good off the glass. 15 first half points for Chris Collins.
Chris Collins has as much respect for that Georgia Tech defense as a puppy has for a newspaper. He don't care who's out there or where they are. Give me the ball.
Chris is at 6 out of 8. Getting back defensively, but fouling is Newbill. It will be the second on the senior from Macon, Georgia.
Bobby Kremitz needs to think about taking Travis Best out. He's a tired player. That pass was to him. He almost couldn't get his hands up. He certainly didn't come to meet it. Oh, great defensive play by Capel. Just picks it off right out of the air. The freshman pushing the ball up the floor. You better know he's looking for his buddy. Watch this. That's a horse shot. And he called for it, and it's a deuce.
Parks misses a three, but there to tip it in is Grant Hill. He's got four, and the Georgia Tech lead is down to three. This is the closest the Blue Devils have been since it was 6-4.
And it's been the Duke defense, just relentless. The smaller lineup, and they're just getting after him.
Forrest. Tipped out to Collins. Duke is running. 3-on-1 with Best back. The shovel to Lang.
Kremitz elects not to go for the timeout. And this place is ballistic.
The shot clock is under 10. Shot clock at 5, 4, 3. Best. Nope. That's a violation.
The good news for Tech is that they kept Duke on defense and stopped that quick hit and chuck and duck. The bad news is Travis Best is tired.
38-37. We'll be back after a word from our good friends at Bud Light. Discus Athletic Community Outreach Award winner is Trelawney Owens from Lake Forest University. Trelawney is a member of the ACC's Athletes Care Team, a group that stresses to youngsters the importance of education, hard work, and staying away from drugs. Owens also has an active role in the Special Olympics, as well as the Santa's Helper Program. Congratulations to our Discus Community Outreach Award winner, Trelawney Owens. Along with Bucky Waters, Bob Rathman back at Cameron Indoor Stadium, and the Dukies are rolling. The Blue Devils on an 11-3 run in the last 4 minutes. And they have taken advantage of the Tech mistakes. They've converted three straight Yellow Jacket turnovers. Now a chance to take the lead. Right down the gut, Collins left it short.
Georgia Tech switching out of the timeout, changing the defense back to man-to-man.
And in transition, Martise Moore slams it home.
Chris Collins went very hard into a camera down there along the baseline. Looks like he's trying to shake it off, but he took a shot.
Yellow Jackets by three. Lang travels, could not hold the pivot foot. 2:18 to go in the half. Mike Krzyzewski's team has not led in this game.
It seemed that he had a premonition for this kind of effort from the Blue Devils yesterday at practice. He really got after them because he just didn't think they were ready to play.
Forrest. Well, Capel at 6'5", claiming the rebound inside. Here's Parks. Tough pass.
The threat of the Collins jump shot brings the perimeter defense out and opens up the inside. He's just doing it all today.
Coming up at halftime, we'll update you on all the scores, the ACC Women's Report, highlights of the first half here, and the statistics of the first half of play. It's been a wonderful game. Georgia Tech leading 40-37. Right underneath, out of bounds, Capel lays it in. Well, Tech fell asleep that time.
Under 2 minutes, Duke has committed only four fouls, so they've got a couple to give down the stretch.
Drew Berry kicks it out to Best. Berry driving and lays it in.
Drew Berry.
Seven for Drew Berry. 42-39, Yellow Jackets.
Martise Moore on Grand Hill appears to be a mismatch in favor of the Blue Devils. But Duke is not going to him.
There's another mismatch, Bucky, with Alisma on Parks. Chief got him on the low blocks and just took him right to the basket.
The big fella just powering in your face, up over the slender freshman from New York City. Yet another angle. Excellent pass. Again, the big point guard, Grand Hill, finds Cherokee underneath, and he punishes number five, the 6'9 freshman, Eddie Alisma.
Alisma's 6'10, but he's giving away close to 40 pounds.
And in the lane, 20 pounds is the universe. 40 pounds, forget it.
Nine for Cherokee. 42-all. Second tie of the game. We were also deadlocked at two.
Duke showing a 1-3-1 zone defense, trapping in the corners. And it caught Georgia Tech by surprise. What that does is take the ball out of the hands of Best and Barry, put it into the corners where Martise Moore and Vincent are not nearly as good of ball handlers. Good gamble paid off for the Blue Devils.
Duke looking for its first lead. Tied at 42, 45 seconds to play. Clark floats it up and off. The Chief. And let's see. Steve Gordon says his foul will be on Eddie Alisma. It'll be his third.
Marty Clark going baseline up over Martise Moore. That shot blocking looks good when you swat them, but when you don't, it takes you off the defensive board. And Cherokee Parks doesn't need much room. But it was just one of him in a sea of blue jerseys. He just won the battle.
Number zero in the lineup for Georgia Tech.
Coming in, Darryl Barnes, number zero for Georgia Tech. Alisma out of there with the three personals. Cherokee, a 79.4 free throw shooter this year, fifth best in the league. ACC action coming up on Tuesday at 8 p.m. Eastern Time as the Seminoles of Florida State travel to College Park to meet the revitalized Terrapins of Maryland. Parks hitting the foul shot. He's got 10 here in the first half, and Duke has its first lead at 43-42.
Duke staying with the half-court trap.
4-second differential between the game clock that you see and the shot clock. And Duke is really, in the last 8 minutes, turned up that defense.
Let's see how long it takes for Georgia Tech to get the ball back in the hands of either Best or Barry once they're forced to give it up against that trap. You better believe they're going to have to solve that, or Coach K will stay right in it. He'll ride it home.
And Drew takes a timeout. So with 23 seconds to play in the first half and 19 seconds on the shot clock, Drew Barry found himself in a world of trouble and burns a timeout. You see that a lot, Buck, at the end of a game, to use a timeout in the first half with 23 seconds to go. I'm not so sure.
Oh, very, very questionable. Yeah, I'm sure that Bobby Kremins would like to have that timeout back, but for the same token, you look at a player like Drew Barry, who plays with a lot more maturity than his years. He's very cavalier with the ball and brazen to a degree, but he's also very confident out there. And I'm not sure he knew how much time was left, but there was no hesitation. He knew he was in trouble, and any pass he made was a breakaway for Duke.
These two teams, of course, have made postseason play fairly routine. Wasn't too long ago they were calling the Final Four the Duke Invitational. But you see, Duke has gone 10 straight years, Georgia Tech 9, and of course the Tar Heels lead everybody with 19. There's one thing about Georgia Tech, and we talked about Bobby Kremins earlier with his three ACC championships. He doesn't get a great deal of credit for his marvelous coaching ability. But here's a man who's won three ACC titles, and if you can do that, my friend, and you know from firsthand experience, you can coach.
I tell you, they always talk about him being a little short on the X's and O's and a great recruiter, but the guy has, like last year, he beat the national champions in the finals of the ACC tournament, took out Duke in the first round. Sure, you got good players, but you don't do that with mirrors.
23 seconds left in the half. Duke on a 19-7 run to seize the lead. Best across the lane to Darryl Barnes. The shot clock at 15. And Travis Best puts it in.
Boy, for a little guy, he's tough along that baseline. He hides down there. Got that quick release to get it up over the big guys.
And a foul inside on Barnes. Stops things with 6 seconds to go in the half. First foul on Darryl.
Fouls on number zero.
And Georgia Tech Darryl is in the penalty.
Barnes is first.
Zero, Barnes.
On the team.
Oh, my, yeah.
He'd get 2 points in wrestling.
Yeah. Either Antonio Lang was growing a tumor out his back or somebody had a hold of his jersey.
Antonio to the foul line, where today he's 1 for 1, 7 points in this first half. And remind your friends, the announcers for this game, selected and compensated by Raycom and Jefferson Pilot Sports, and the use of this broadcast without their express permission is prohibited. Duke steal, out of bounds, Georgia Tech ball, and the clock hasn't run. It's still at 6.
Bob Rathman, if he would have made that steal and stuffed it, this old building might have imploded. What a play. Remember now, Duke has turned their personnel over very well, and I still contend that Barry and Best were dragging a little bit at the end, which helped to Duke to reduce that lead.
They did have a clock problem as Lang bats it out of bounds again. It has been reset to show 4 seconds that you see. 45-44 Duke, and Tech having difficulty.
Tech doesn't want another timeout here just to get the ball in bounds.
Here's Barry. from midcourt to Best at the buzzer. It won't count. No basket. The horn sounded before Best could get it off.
What a half a basketball.
I guess so.
I'm Duke coming back 45. For the second half. How about you?
I'll be here. Duke 45 and Georgia Tech 44. Stay with us. Halftime is straight ahead.
Today's ACC action is brought to you by Pizza Hut, Ford Mustang, Food Lion, and by the Jefferson Pilot Life Insurance Company.
5:44, Duke leading Georgia Tech here at halftime. And what a first half it was. Welcome back, everybody. Bob Rathbun along with Bucky Waters. Georgia Tech in control early. They dominated inside with Evander Newbill. But then Duke tightened its defense, and the Blue Devils, as they've done so often, used that defense to make a great surge, and they have the lead here at halftime. We're going to show you the final shot. Georgia Tech had some difficulty, Bucky, getting the ball inbounds.
They really did. The Duke defense tightened up, as you mentioned, both the zone, the half-court trap, and the man for man. But the good guard play right there by Barry and Best, just a split second short, that would have really helped Georgia Tech's confidence if they would have gotten that one to go down.
No question that Georgia Tech has to do a better job getting the ball into Best in Barry's hands.
Well, yeah, it's Best has been taken out of the game pretty much by Grant Hill, but also Grant Hill has been taken out of the Duke offense. That whole comeback almost was without Hill being a factor. That's amazing.
It is. Right now, let's check our nationwide Scholar Athlete of the Week. And it is Mark Blukas from Wake Forest University. Mark, a 6'3" guard from Girard, Pennsylvania, with a 3.1 grade point average in business and pre-law. Lucas is a member of the ACC Honor Roll and a Dean's List student at Wake Forest. Our congratulations to nationwide Scholar Athlete Mark Blukas. Commercial coming here from Cameron Indoor Stadium as the Blue Devils lead the Yellow Jackets 45-44. We'll be right back. Stadium with Duke leading Georgia Tech here at halftime 45-44. Bob Rathbun, Bucky Waters, and let's take a look at the Budweiser scoreboard. And we've had a big upset today. Number one Arkansas going down to defeat. We'll get to that in just a moment. In the ACC today, number two North Carolina held off Maryland to win 75-70. Very good showing, Bucky, for the Terrapins today.
Cliff Ellis, after announcing his retirement at the end of the season, coming back against a tough UNC Charlotte team.
Wake Forest up big in Tallahassee over Florida State. Temple bouncing back after the West Virginia loss to knock off GW today. UMass over Duquesne in Atlantic 10 action. Number 11, Louisville, losing at home to VCU. My goodness. And there's the Arkansas defeat we mentioned in Alabama. Well, the Crimson Tide has had a rough go of it this season, but not today. They pulled a stunner over the Razorbacks.
And it looks like Carolina winning on the road could go to number one. And if Duke wins here today, it'll be 1-2 in the ACC.
Vanderbilt over South Carolina. Michigan's got its hands full with Iowa today in the second half. Florida winning big at Tennessee. And LSU in the first half, leading Auburn 35-30. Here at the half, Duke is leading by just 1 point. It's really been two different games. Georgia Tech had the emphasis inside, and they were succeeding with Evander Newbill in that first half. But then Duke came back, and with their defensive toughness, really got back in the game.
The incredible stat is that Grant Hill has like 4 points, two assists, and one rebound. And Duke has scored 45 points and held off a tremendous challenge.
Indeed. Atlantic Coast Conference basketball on the Raycom and Jefferson Pilot Sports Network will continue after these messages from your local ACC station. Twenty times the Yellow Jackets have journeyed to Durham. 17 times they have gone home losers. Georgia Tech has dropped 6 consecutive games in this particular series here at Cameron Indoor Stadium, but they're right with the Blue Devils after the first 20 minutes today, 45-44 here at halftime. We will continue with more in just a moment, but first we are going to take a look at these two respective universities, Georgia Tech and Duke.
I'm never satisfied with being second best in anything. I want Georgia Tech to be the premier technological university in the next century. And that means we have to have the premier student body. For more than 100 years, Georgia Tech has enjoyed a flow of talent through this institution that is unprecedented. No other university has ever had the opportunity that Georgia Tech has over the next 5 or 6 years.
From the preservation of our forests to the conservation of the plants and animals that inhabit them, environmental issues have a long history at Duke University. For decades, Duke students and researchers have worked in an outstanding academic climate to answer some of the world's most urgent problems, like the destruction of tropical plants used for medicine, or adapting to the damage caused by ozone and acid rain. Finding answers for the future, Duke University. This message presented by the Atlantic Coast Conference.
We are back at Cameron. Bob Rathbun, Bucky Waters, 45-44 Duke here at halftime. And let's take a look at some of the highlights of that first half. And Bucky, our U.S. Air halftime stats, first of all, and you'll see Georgia Tech is shooting 64% from the game, and they did a lot of that inside early.
They really did. Duke prides itself on defense, and certainly when it's enforced by this great crowd at Cameron, that's an astounding statistic. Georgia Tech yet to miss a three-point shot, and they were hard, 6-for-33 against Maryland at home. Nothing really makes sense on that stat chart.
Inside early, Ivan Onubil, an unexpected pleasure.
Yes, James Forrest drawing the double team, and that leaves Ivano open underneath, and he goes up over Clark. He had a huge half and helped to give the Georgia Tech team confidence and an inside game. But the guy that turned this crowd on, Chris Collins, with a whirling dervish, a nine-point dive, and he drilled it. He did everything with the basketball. He passed especially well.
Getting set for the second half of action. Georgia Tech and Duke will have it for you right after these words.
Raycom and Jefferson Final Sports exclusive coverage of ACC basketball is brought to you by Discus Athletic, Budweiser, Central Fidelity Bank, and by Nationwide Insurance.
The Blue Devils trying to protect their perfect record, 8-0 coming into this game, their first ACC home contest at a dandy with the Yellow Jackets, 45-44. The leading scorers in the first half of play for the Georgia Tech Yellow Jackets. Big first half from James Forrest with a dozen, but we're used to that. But look who's number two, Ivan Onubil with nine. And we talked, Bucky, about Collins with his great first half, three threes and 15 points, and the Chief checks in with double figures also.
Travis Best and Grant Hill nowhere among the leaders at the half. This has really been one amazing half of basketball. Both coaches feeling like they're getting key contributions from the guys that they don't count on.
Lang. Parks inside. Getting a hand on it was Travis Best, and it's out of bounds to Duke.
Travis Best at 5'11". Watch him down inside digging. Let's see if he reaches from the bottom up. No, that's dangerous. That's a dangerous reach. When you're down in there trying to create the loose ball, it's better to go from the bottom up. Normally when you come down, those officials start to pucker their teeth and the whistle just blows. That's a pretty good step there, but a zebra doing a little Fred Astaire.
Mike Wood. Very talented. Parks, another offensive rebound, and he scores. 12 points for the Chief. 47-44, Duke by three.
Grant Hill not guarding Travis Best to start the second half. Mike Krzyzewski, I'm sure, trying to get more offense out of Grant Hill. And Capel, at 6'5", is a very capable defender.
Grant with the rebound. Capel around to Collins.
Bad pass.
His feet set and had to go chase the ball.
Collins was really set to take the jumper right off the pass, and Capel made him reach for it.
Drew Berry, foul number two.
That's one of those things that where you miss a Bobby Hurley. When that ball's rotating and your spot-up shooter's there, the good guards put it right on the numbers, so all you got to do is release it. And that pass was hurried and pulled him off his spot. Double high screen. Mike Krzyzewski definitely going to Grant Hill offensively in this second half to get him in the game and taking the tough defensive assignment away from him.
Nice soft touch from Martise Moore. He has scored nine. Georgia Tech within three. Parks gets a little closer. Newbill, the flat-footed rebound. Best breaks out. Forrest blocked by Lang. Collins saves it. Cable pulls up. Got it. 51-46. Duke has come from 13 down. Yeah.
Cremins has really got to keep his finger on his pulse. It's getting away from him. He may need to think about a timeout. Nothing's going right now for the Yellow Jackets.
Travis Best with the charge. Capel guarding him, but look at the pop out by Lang.
Boy, that's great defense. There was no hedging, no hesitation. Tony Lang just went out there and put his body right in his path, and you got to be quick to do that.
Travis Best with two field goals and now one foul.
Grant Hill with the ball with the double high screen. Duke's going to stay with this until Tech solves it.
What a move.
The 11 o'clock news.
And there is the timeout by Coach Cremins. 17-27 to play. Duke now leading Georgia Tech by 7. We'll be back after a word from our good friends at Bud Light. Duke 53, Georgia Tech 46 here early in the second half. Georgia Tech has used two timeouts now, so they have only one remaining. And a look at the leading scorers for their respective teams, and here's Grant picking it up just a bit. Hill with the four now in the second half, and Travis with four for the game.
Duke going back to the 1-3-1 half court. Very soft trap in the corner that time.
Artis Moore silences the crowd. It's a two-pointer. He's got 11.
The perimeter jump shot is going to be open against that defense, but it should cut down on the dribble penetration and neutralize the guards by taking the ball out of their hands. But it is a gamble. You will give the perimeter shot, and that's one of Georgia Tech's strengths. Yellow Jackets back in the man for man.
Shot clock winding down. Cable beats the shot clock. Buzzer with a three-pointer.
Boy, that's a heartbreaker for the defense. They really did a nice job containing Duke that time. But the big point guard, Hill, just penetrated and hit to the spot up, and Cable drilled it. Hill back on Best.
Lang has Forrest. Collins at the deck. Best for three. Nope. The foul is on Cherokee Parks, his first.
That's an amazing stat. Normally the Chiefs rattling people in there. Good looking stroke, but this one catches iron. When you see Cherokee only rebounding on one hand, you have to wonder where the other one is, and the official found it that time.
Newbill puts it home. 11 for Ivano, and that's a season high. His career high is 15. That came against Tulane in 1990.
Boy, if nothing else, even if Tech can't pull a win out of here today, if that's the start of a straight finish to a senior year, Bobby Tech's got to be pleased with the rest of that arsenal. A center would make them very, very tough.
Parks with 14, and the Duke lead stands at 8. Bob Rathbun, Bucky Waters at Cameron Indoor Stadium. Foul on Grant Hill, number three, and it comes with 15-19 remaining. Martin
Tatis Moore is probably the player he should guard, even though he just fouled him. Moore is not the kind of a player that puts a great deal of pressure on you, primarily a jump shooter. If you guard a Travis Best, you got your problems. He'll drive by you.
Stay tuned for the Nations Bank Players of the Game Award. Nations Bank will contribute $1,000 to the Atlantic Coast Conference Postgraduate Scholarship Program. Since 1971, contributions to the program have helped fund postgraduate educational opportunities for over 50 deserving student athletes. Martise Moore, a 71% foul shooter. Big game against St. John's at the ECAC Holiday Festival. 19 points, 8 rebounds, and 3 steals. Double figures for the fifth time this season today.
It earned him MVP honors in the Holiday Festival. And that great old tournament, when you look down the MVPs, it's Bill Russell, Bill Bradley, Oscar Robertson, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. It's almost a walking Hall of Fame. And you come down there and you say, Martise Moore, well, he may make it, but in two seasons, that was high cotton for him.
Duke 58, Georgia Tech 50. Parks clears to Collins. Collins all the way. Oh, and a big elbow by Newbill got Lang out of the vicinity.
But the Duke coaching staff up as well.
And Barry jams it in.
That was facial for Cherokee Parks. I don't think he thought Drew Barry was going to challenge him.
The youngest of the four Barry boys, Drew with 9. Lang.
There's that shot, though, 8 inches inside the three-point line. Tony Lang should have been spotted up 8 inches further back, and he'd have been shooting for 3. You really don't want to shoot that 18-foot jumper. It ought to be 19 or 10 or 12.
Has not attempted a three-point shot this season. Collins tipped it away, but Moore. Oh, look at Collins knock it away. Martise was going back to pick it up, but Collins with a great second effort, diving, knocks it away.
To a very appreciative crowd. It's hard not to hustle when you're playing alongside of a guy with that kind of enthusiasm. Now, Georgia Tech had a guard like that a few years back, Bruce Dalrymple, who wasn't a very good shooter. And you know, you might say, well, he really wasn't a very good guard. He just made everybody tougher. He was a power guard. And his kind of enthusiasm and strength was infectious.
Cable and Parks out. Clark and Meek in the game for Duke. Vincent. And the foul will be called on Grant Hill. Or is it? No, it's going to go against Georgia Tech and Newbill.
Good pump fake. Vincent takes the J. Where does that foul come from? Ivano Newbill submarining Eric Meek. That was the call.
13:45 remaining.
Grant Hill now on the baseline. Marty Clark off the top of the key.
Lang inside. Hammered by Newbill. And Newbill complaining that Lang cleared out with the elbow, but to no avail.
Chris Collins lets it go, catches iron, even a long shot, comes off soft. Watch the move. No, I don't think so. I don't think so. Well, that's big. The way Ivano Newbill has played today, that's big. With 13:33 to go, the battle of the boards remains critical. It remains critical because Georgia Tech can't run without defensive rebounds, and they've been so vulnerable all year to giving up those stick backs off the offensive glass. They served a banquet in New York, giving up 24 offensive boards and 25 offensive boards, and miraculously won the tournament against quality competition in Temple and St. John's.
13 points for Antonio Lang. Duke enjoying its biggest lead of the game, 62-52.
Replacing number 34, James
Forrest goes to the Georgia Tech bench.
Looking at that lineup on the floor, Duke better concentrate on Travis Best. One, he's been tired, and two, most of the offensive performers are on the bench right now, and James Forrest, he's the other big gun.
And Marty Clark with the reach-in. Second foul on Marty. Eddie Elisman is back in the game for Georgia Tech.
This is where Duke misses Kenny Blakeney, who became academically ineligible earlier this week, but he had that kind of quickness that could help to neutralize a Travis Best. He's a tough assignment for Marty Clark at 6'6".
Leesmith trying to spring Best free with a screen. Nice fake, shovel. Grant Hill got a piece of it, and Lang takes it away. Collins out to Grant. Nice hang time for Tony. He's got 15 now, and Duke leads by a dozen. Travis drills it.
2-pointer by Travis Best.
Best with 6. He's been averaging 18-7. Grant Hill. And the foul is called, and Eric Meek is the guilty party.
Duke foul. Well,
James, excuse me, Bob, while James Forrest is resting again, I make the point Duke better really concentrate on Travis Best so that he doesn't get off. No question, this guy is their leader. And he's explosive.
Hasn't been able to burn Duke today with a three-pointer.
They've had a tall guy on him all day. First it was Grant Hill, then it was Jeff Capel, and Marty Clark at 6'6". That's tough on the little guy to get it up over him.
Malisma up and over Antonio Lang. His first basket of the game.
Boy, Malisma had a huge game defensively in New York. With 6 rejects, tied John Sally and Matt Geiger's record at Georgia Tech. He's very quick to the ball, but as you pointed out earlier, in ACC competition, he's a little skinny in there. He's getting moved around, but he's going to be a good one.
Grant Hill misses the three. Meek back out to Collins. Another 3-point. Too long. Grant dunks. That's the sure 2. Double figures for Grant with 10. He had his career high in Atlanta against Georgia Tech last year with 29. Blue Devils by 10.
You think the fact that Chris Collins missed that rim with a jump shot will deter his next shot? You think that'll bother him at all?
I can't think so. A timeout on the floor here at Cameron. 11-14 to play. Grant Hill and the Blue Devils leading Georgia Tech 66-56. Now up by 10 with 11-14 to play. And inside today, Cherokee Parks and Evando Newbill. Big stories in this contest. Newbill having a season high 11 against the Blue Devils, and Parks chiming in with 14 of his own.
Parks coming off an impressive double-double against Sharon Wright at Clemson, and Duke needed it all. Down 3 at the half. As always, the Tigers played him tough down there in Death Valley, but this time they survived.
Earlier this season, the Chief had a 20-rebound night against Xavier. And it reminds us that the all-time Duke leading rebounder, Mike Jaminski, never had a 20-rebound game in his career here at Durham. But the Chief has one to his credit. Parks trying to get the bounce pass. Capel trying to force it in there.
Yellow Jackets again. A smart move by Bobby Kremins out of the timeout, going to the half-court trap. But Duke napping, got the turnover.
Travis. And Best comes up with a loose ball. Nice touch pass to Forrest, and he lays it in. James Forrest with 14. That's the first made basket for James in his last 8 attempts.
Yeah, he'd been 0 for 3 this half, and he had such a big first half with 12 points. Maybe that'll get him going. The Chief with range.
And 16 points. 68-58.
Blue Devils, man for man.
Travis Best has scored over 24 times in a game this season. Points hard to come by today, only 6.
Jeff Capel, the freshman, now has got the assignment to track Travis Best.
Berry cuts in, kicks it out. Back in it goes, and a foul. Grant Hill picks up number four, 10:06 to play.
I was just going to say that if I were Georgia Tech with 10 minutes to go, I would take a couple of drives, a couple of power plays right at Grant Hill, see if I couldn't pick up that fourth one, because he is so critical to their management of time and distance coming down the stretch, as in managing the clock.
Travis can't get it to go. Allen's the rebound. Loose ball. There's Travis Best. Tech pushes it ahead. Best takes it up and leaves it short. Forrest the rebound. Back to Best. Outside to Barry. Tough time down the floor that time for Georgia Tech. They got the turnover and couldn't convert.
Yeah, they really had their chances. The defense has held up pretty good for them. They just haven't been able to convert. Well, they better do it now with Grant Hill on the bench. Down 10. And it's now just under 10.
So Tech's trying to get organized defensively, and Marty Clark is left alone. Well, you can see Travis Best was pointing and gesturing, and people were moving.
When you snooze, you lose. Marty Clark, the senior, just slipped out there, got the great pass, didn't have to do anything but release it.
Forrest draws the foul. It's on Antonio Lang, his first. And James Forrest to the line.
On the team. Number 24, Fred Vincent returns to the lineup for Georgia Tech.
A three-guard attack now, if you consider Marty
James
Clark
Forrest,
a guard, which I do.
For Georgia Tech, two shots.
The three-guard approach by Duke today has been especially effective defensively. It has given him a little extra quickness.
James Forrest, 15 points. Fred Vincent has returned to the Tech lineup. And James hits them both. He's got a big week going. 36 Tuesday against the Terrapins. A career best.
He's still not the player he was at the end of last year. He picked up 10, 15 pounds, and it has slowed him down considerably, I think. He's still got to play that weight down. But we're just early January. Lots of hoops to be played. And really important things happen in March and April.
Capel with the left hand misses. Vincent. The rebound. Tech trailing by 10, 70-60. Travis to Newbill. Fumbled it away. Out of bounds. Georgia Tech ball.
Georgia Tech keeps wanting to go to Newbill, and he's not as assertive and ready for that pass as he was early in the game.
Come on, guys. Come on.
Nobody could stick a fork in this one.
Was that right off Gowland's noggin?
Yeah, well, a lot of the crowd didn't see that. It looked like it was off Tech. Most of the time, the officials are right.
No team has shot over 50% against the Blue Devils this year. Tech's been over 50 all day. Forrest, oops, puts it back up. Now Travis for three. And that's his first three-pointer of the game.
Led the ACC last year with 45%. That percentage is down this year to high 30s, but he is capable.
Clark. Antonio Lang. 17 for the Mobile, Alabama senior.
Boy, that little jump shot has really made him a different player.
Collins couldn't control it as he and Meek hit the deck.
Chris Collins throws his body around like he has a spare. It's just great to see the enthusiasm he plays with.
Diamond on the floor, 7:40 remaining, Duke by 9. We'll be back after a word from our good friends at Budweiser.
Sunday mornings.
Let's look at an MCI proof positive instant replay. Tech Bucky is outstanding in transition, and Newbill delivers a blow to Lang and triggers the fast break.
Cleans the sinuses and finds Travis Best at midcourt. Here comes Drew Barry. Cherokee Parks gets back too little too late. Thank you very much. I mean, I'm telling you, this guy plays with a brazen kind of confident attitude. Not too many 6'4 guards will take it at the cheek. He did, and won.
Duke has out-rebounded Georgia Tech 12-6 here in the second half. And have out-rebounded the Yellow Jackets for the game 26-18. Duke leading now by 9. 7:40 to play. Vincent.
Grant Hill still on the bench with 4 fouls.
And Tech trying to feed it inside. Turns it over.
Early in the game, Forrest and Newville were making those tough catches and converting them to baskets. A little bit of fatigue again on this Georgia Tech team. This is not a deep team. They wear down. Duke, on the other hand, has turned their bench over, utilized it, and it's going to pay off in this hot building. It should be right here in the last quarter.
Collins. Right, Chris is having a big day. That matches his career high with 17. He also had 17 at Iowa a couple of weeks ago.
Controlling the clock, keeping Duke on defense.
Artis Moore, air ball.
That wasn't even close.
Collins, Capel for 3. 14-point Duke lead, just like that.
The backcourt of Capel and Collins getting more and more confident with each game.
Rejected by Lang. Forrest gets it back. Tries it again. Couldn't score over Parks this time. And a foul is called on Marty Clark. Boy, it's a great D this time by Lang.
There's that penetration pass. James Forrest taking it at Tony Lang. He says, out of here. Guess who's on the floor again? Keep it alive, Chris Collins. Keep it alive.
Lang, a senior, expected to carry a lot of the leadership duties for this Duke team. And he was quoted in an article earlier this year that says, I've learned from the great leaders that I've played with through this program. And most apply some of those things that he's learned to this Duke team in 94. Try captain Antonio Lang. This is Newbill and misses the front end. Georgia Tech with 4 team fouls, so they can gamble a little bit, try to come up with some steals, not put Duke on the line. Forrest knocks it away, and Berry picks it up.
That's the part of the game that Grant Hill normally handles the ball in the midcourt.
Forrest, score it, and a foul.
It's like the rocket Gibraltar in there. He's still not jumping as high or moving as quick as a result of that additional weight, but he just is immovable in there. Marty Clark with a pretty good defensive play. Eric can't get the handle on the ball, and there's the quick release by James Forrest. A mountain with a touch.
Mr. Grant Hill returns to the Duke lineup. Chris Collins goes off. Lang is also back in the game for Duke, with Eric Meek on the bench.
Georgia Tech has in its arsenal a full court 1-2-1-1 full court press, and it might not be bad to hit him with it right here, because if Duke advances over half court, Grant Hill's going to take over the ball, they're going to spread the floor, and they're going to make it tough on the Yellow Jackets.
Vincent, the offensive rebound. Berry for 3. Too long.
Grant Hill has to be careful in this situation not to get that fifth foul with a charge. The Georgia Tech defense is going to come at him, and he's going to be tempted to penetrate.
Shot clock now under 10, as you see. And Grant dribbled it and lost it. Out of bounds.
Just under 5 minutes with a 12-point spread. I'm not sure Georgia Tech can afford to let the shot clock run out every Duke possession.
But it just shows you, Bucky, the effect of that 5-second count not in effect against the dribbler.
Yeah, it would be just as devastating if Georgia Tech had the lead and they had to chase Travis Best. That's really a strength.
Lang. Oh, angled back and scored. He was buried behind the backboard. Still was able to come back and get the shot off. A 14-point Duke advantage.
Back on Travis Best.
Newbill tried to get Best a screen, but he couldn't get the shot off. Vincent faking, firing, and hitting. It was seven. 79-67, Duke.
Yellow Jackets extending now. Vincent on Grant Hill. Advantage Duke.
Vincent finds that three-point line and travels. Duke will have the basketball when we come back. 3 minutes and 35 seconds left to go in the ballgame. Duke 79, Georgia Tech 67. We've got more ACC action coming up for you next week. And we begin our coverage Tuesday night at 8 p.m. Check the station in your local area for the action between Florida State and Maryland from Cole Fieldhouse. North Carolina beat the Terps earlier today. Carolina going to 2-0 in league play. Look at the drop-off for Georgia Tech in field goal shooting, down to 35-7 here in the second half.
I think it's two factors, Bob. One, I think Duke certainly improved its defensive intensity. And two, I think the Georgia Tech players tired in here. It's a hot, muggy building, and especially that backcourt. Travis Best is not having a good day. And I think several times I pointed it out, hands on the hips, sucking air. It's a long way to go with Duke wearing you out defensively as they do. Here they come with half-court pressure now.
And trying to trap out of that pressure. Duke backs it out with Grant Hill.
Elise Grant Hill at midcourt is not a good situation for Georgia Tech.
Shot clock at 10. Lang. He's hit a couple of those today, Bucky. An outstanding offensive afternoon for Lang. 21 points, a career best.
He's getting such a thrust on that fadeaway. He takes it in, gets right up against the defender, and then just propels himself back with a soft touch. And he's got that quickness that's very difficult to defend. He has really developed himself offensively. He's been a good rebounder and a good defender for Duke.
Meanwhile, a rough day for Travis. Only 9 points. And the turnovers and assist ratio, which is the best in the conference and better than 2-1 today, is even at 3-3.
He's only had 12 shots, 4-for-12 for 9 points. Georgia Tech still has committed only 4 fouls, and they need to begin to think of using all of their resources. They've got a couple fouls to give, and they have 1 timeout. Duke is holding 3 timeouts.
Best has so many ways to beat you. He can get you in the transition game, coming off a screen, or driving to the bucket. But Duke, Bucky, has pretty much taken all three things away from him.
Yeah, the Duke size, and especially the people that have covered him, starting with Grant Hill, and Jeff Capel, and Marty Clark, all of them have several inches on him, and he hasn't been able to make the dribble penetration. And that's a credit to the team structure of the Duke defense. Tough to go all the way against them. Oh, wide open.
And Antonio Lang with 23 now, and Duke leads 83-69.
He was as lonesome as a hitchhiker with pets. There was nobody with him. Elise Mount there looks a little lost at the top of the key, doesn't he?
Elise Mount blocked by Grant Hill into the hands of Lang.
And that with 4 fouls.
Very uptight on Clark, trying to poke it away. And does. and a foul, and it will be on Marty Clark. And he said, hey, wait a minute, what about Barry on me? I didn't get the call.
Actually, it was a good foul. Had he not made that foul, Georgia Tech had a clear breakaway. Drew Barry was all by himself up the floor. Would have been a gimme.
Number 44, Cherokee Parks, returns to the blue lineup, replacing Marty Clark.
Parks is back in for Marty Clark.
James Forrest at the line for Georgia Tech. Two shots.
James Forrest, one of the Wooden nominees, getting the foul shot. 19 in the game for James, 83-70 Duke.
Number 23.
Now coming in is Martise Moore for Georgia Tech. Or will he? I think he's going to come in for Forrest. Right now huddled with Bobby Crummins in front of the Georgia Tech bench.
Number 23, Martise Moore.
Now Moore is in, and Forrest will come out. Or will he? No, it's going to be Drew Barry that comes in. Full court pressure now from Georgia Tech, and we've got a foul. Just the 15th foul on Georgia Tech. So Duke will have to play it in. Forrest with his third foul. Georgia Tech had its way inside early in this game. Newbill and Forrest combined for 21 in the first half. Second half, they've got 10 between them. Duke beats the press. A minute 35 to play. And Alisma with the hand check and his fourth foul. What do you think about this Georgia Tech situation, Bucky? Here they are, having lost to Maryland at home, trailing by 12, and they've got North Carolina coming up on Wednesday night in Atlanta. A tough stretch of games. Then after Carolina for Bobby Crummins, it's on to Louisville. My goodness.
Yeah. I wonder if his hair is white.
Well, you got to be optimistic.
Yeah. Right.
Optimistic is going to rent an apartment with a bass drum under your arm. That's optimistic.
That's optimistic. Well, he's got to look at North Carolina just winning by 5 at College Park is you know, not an impossible situation. And the Tar Heels will be coming in there number one as a result of their win today and the Arkansas loss. And Georgia Tech took Duke when they were number one in Atlanta last year. So I'm sure that they can get creative and figure out lots of reasons why that would be a good time to bounce back.
Fred Benson with the foul, 53 seconds to play.
Fred Benson, his first 17
fouls on Tech, so now the Blue Devils will shoot 1-1.
Number 42, Joey Beard, and number 30, Tony Moore.
Changes for Duke. Tony Moore is in, and Lang goes on. Tony Moore is also in for the Blue Devils, and Jeff Capel comes out of the game. Here's Tony, 6'8 sophomore from Washington, D.C. Now Collins is at the line, matching his career best with 17 this afternoon. And look at that, 8 rebounds.
Well, he had a huge, huge contribution today when the inside wasn't going at all. For Duke, and Brand Hill just couldn't get started offensively. He stepped up big. 8 boards. Boy, he's gonna be hard to live with. And guards rebound good like that. They can really get wordy.
No basket. Meek will go to the line. 86-71 Duke. 50 seconds left.
Good check off inside. Meek gets that one waist high and forces it back up. The front line of Georgia Tech. Just not with it in the second half.
Here's Grant coming out in favor of Greg Newton, the 6'11 freshman from Niagara Falls, Ontario, Canada. Eric Meek, who's had some fine efforts for the Blue Devils in this still fairly young season. Duke's 9th game of the year today. 86-71. Called against Eric Meek.
He traveled all right. He flew.
Well, the frustration continues for Georgia Tech here at Cameron as Bobby Crummins goes to the bench to get Todd Harlicka in the game. A long afternoon for Travis Best. 1 3-pointer and only 11 points. Under his average by 7.5. Georgia Tech will absorb its 7th consecutive defeat here at Cameron. Here's Newton zipping it ahead to Joey Beard. Shovels to Meek for the dunk. Youth will be served here in the last seconds of this game. 88-71. And this one out of bounds with 10 seconds to go.
Eddie Leesman came across the lane, and one of the problems, he could be a really good player in the ACC. He's having trouble with the catch. A number of times, he just doesn't look that ball in his hand. And if he can just master that with his quickness in the lane, he's going to be very difficult to defend.
Rod Balanis missing 2 seconds, one, and Corey Wallace at midcourt watches this one end in Duke's favor. An impressive victory for the Blue Devils here this afternoon. Our final score from Cameron Indoor Stadium is Duke 88 and Georgia Tech 71. Stay with us. We'll have our comments in just a moment after this from our good friends at Budweiser.
Action has been brought to you by USA, Nations Bank, MCI, Schick Tracer, and by Nationwide Insurance.
Georgia Tech had lost its 6 previous games in Cameron by an average margin of defeat of 17 points. They lose by 17 this afternoon. Duke 88, Georgia Tech 71. The Blue Devils remain unbeaten. The nation's number 3rd-ranked team is now 9-0 and 2-0 in the ACC. Number 12, Georgia Tech falls to 9-3 and 0-2 in ACC play. We talked about the Yellow Jackets. They've got the Tar Heels coming up in Atlanta next. Meanwhile, Duke has a non-conference game here Monday night against Brown. Wake Forest will be here Thursday. And the Blue Devils go to Virginia a week from today, the up-and-coming schedule. It's time now for the Pizza Hut delivery of the game. And Marty Clark, Bucky, will get this one started from the guard position.
Boy, he gave Duke a tremendous lift off the bench. He finds underneath Tony Lang, who was all alone and went for a career high today, 23. Huge inside player, played good defensively, and gave him that inside punch when Grant Hill was struggling. Duke bench was important today.
Antonio Lang had a career high 23 points this afternoon, and 14 of those points coming in the second half of play. Also, Cherokee Parks added 16. Grant Hill had a dozen, plagued with foul problems in the second half. Jeff Capel had 10, hit 2 threes. Chris Collins with a career best 18. So all 5 Duke starters reaching double figures here this afternoon. Meanwhile, for Georgia Tech, James Forrest, the team's leading scorer, had 20 here this afternoon, but Travis Best, the number 2 man right behind James in the scoring list, had only 11. He came in averaging 18.7. Martise Moore with 11. Aveno Newbill with a season-high 11 today. Did a lot of damage in the first half. And Drew Berry with 9. The Yellow Jackets have now dropped consecutive games this week. They've got the Tar Heels coming up on Wednesday night in Atlanta. The Yellow Jackets, Bucky, as you look back, as Duke clamped down defensively, but the one thing that Tech was doing when they had that impressive first half lead, they were getting some things done inside, and they were limiting Duke on the offensive glass. You look back over the season, Tuesday night they were out-rebounded by 14 against Maryland, 10 by St. John's, 18 by Georgia, 3 by Michigan. They've got the Tar Heels coming in with all those 7-footers on Wednesday night. Bobby Crummins knows that they've got to figure out a way to stay alive on the backboard.
Well, with those 7-footers at North Carolina and their 14 rejects the other night against NC State, they have given SWAT team a new dimension, for sure. If he thought it was tough to get something going inside against Duke in the second half, it's going to be very difficult against the Tar Heels. And, of course, the Tar Heels will come in there as the nation's number one team. They started out there on the strength of defending the national championship. We're upset by Massachusetts, and now they're going to be back in that number one role as a result of winning today and Arkansas losing. Duke will move up to 2, and Bobby Crummins is caught in the eye of a hurricane with that schedule.
Here's a look at the final statistics of today's game. the Blue Devils, the number one shooting team in the ACC, coming in at 52%. Today, they shoot 58% with a great second half effort. And Georgia Tech at 46-6. Look at the rebounding. 13 is the margin in favor of Duke.
Very powerful inside. That's how we build it. The perimeter of Georgia Tech against the inside strength of Duke. And in the first half, it was completely reversed. But they held true to form in the second half. Again, the Duke bench in this building, it was a warm day, hot. And I think that helped to contribute to the demise of Georgia Tech in the second half.
One other factor that you pointed out, Bucky, Duke is not going to hang their hat on Grant Hill each and every night. He had a poor first half here today, but bounced back. But Jeff Capel and Doug Collins picked up that slack, and they continue to gain in confidence.
Yeah, and Marty Clark as well, mm-hmm. off the perimeter. They got good play from their bench. I think Mike Krzyzewski will look back at the decision to put Grant Hill on Travis Best, and while it was very successful defensively, it certainly took Grant Hill out of the offensive flow, or seemed to. He just couldn't get started. Had a lot of easy shots. He couldn't seem to get down, but that's where Doug Collins really picked that club up. And, of course, Antonio Lang, not known to be a power offensively, and that's the mixture of a very good team, a team that's difficult to defend. Lots of weapons.
We'll be back with some more comments in just a moment. The final score here at Cameron Indoor Stadium, Duke 88, Georgia Tech 71. We'll be right back. Duke 88, Georgia Tech 71, our final score, and our Nation's Bank players of the game today. For the Yellow Jackets of Georgia Tech, James Forrest with 20 points and 6 rebounds. And for Duke, Chris Collins, a career-high 18 points and a career-high 8 rebounds today. And Chris joins us next. Chris, our congratulations. That was an outstanding game for you and the Blue Devils.
Yeah, we really wanted to come out and play hard today. We knew Georgia Tech was coming off a tough loss against Maryland and at home, and they were going to come out hard, and we really wanted to have full intensity the whole game, and we were real pleased with our performance today.
Chris, this is Bucky Waters. I know you're going to want to talk about the 18 points, but I know that Coach Krzyzewski is going to want to talk about those 8 rebounds.
Yeah, he was really on me for getting down there and just creating a lot of havoc down low when guys were in the post and be able to get the long rebounds. We knew Georgia Tech was going to take a lot of 3-point shots, and you know, I wanted to make a concerted effort to go in there and grab some boards, and you know, that's probably the stat that I'm most proud about.
How much of an effect do you think Grant Hill's size had on Travis Best? He really was neutralized today.
Yeah, I think Grant did a great job. You know, he took it as a personal challenge guarding Best, and I think our whole defense was great. Antonio Lang and Cherokee did a great job inside when they did penetrate to block shots and get big rebounds, and we're just really happy about this win. It's good to get off to a good start in the conference.
Coming up, you've got Brown Monday, but a big week, 3 games next week. The Deacons will be here, then it's on to Virginia. Time to throw it into high gear, right?
Yeah, you know, the ACC conference, you know, jumps right at you. We got some guys ready to play. We got some young guys mixed in with some experienced players. And, you know, hopefully we can keep it going and just continue to get better and better as a team.
That was a great game for Tony Lang today, too.
Yeah, he played great. We wanted to get him the ball. We knew, you know, we wanted him to attack their guys inside, that he could create mismatches on some of their players. And he came up big, had a great shooting day, pulled down some big boards. And, you know, he's a senior. He's playing great.
Chris, thank you very much. Our congratulations.
Thank you guys a lot.
Chris Collins joining us from courtside as the Blue Devils have defeated Georgia Tech 88-71. The young sophomore is going to be a big factor, we're sure, for Duke this season.
Actually, their backcourt, Jeff Capel coming along as a freshman, that's going to be a dynamite young backcourt as this season progresses, defensively and offensively. This team is coming together, different than any Mike Krzyzewski team. It's his biggest team. It's not going to be the fast-breaking team, but they're developing a lot of depth and a lot of ways to beat you. They needed to go to plan B and C today.
The Dukies continue the magic here at Cameron. Duke has now won 49 of its last 51 and 68 of its last 71 here at home. The final score once again, Duke 88, Georgia Tech 71. For Bucky Waters, this is Bob Rathman. You've been watching exclusive coverage of ACC basketball on the Raycom and Jefferson Pilot Sports Network.